Welcome, everyone. This is the second day of NordSec 2021. And today we start with a keynote by Dr. David Arroyo, who is a tenured scientist in the Institute of Physical and Information Technologies of the Spanish National Research Council. His research is mainly devoted to inter and multidisciplinary applications in the areas of cryptography, information security and privacy, decentralized trust and blockchain, information theory and coding, signal processing, and nonlinear dynamics. He also collaborates with the Spanish Association for Standardization as an expert in the committees for cybersecurity and protection of personal data, blockchain and distributed ledger technologies, and artificial intelligence and big data. He's also currently involved in two H2020 projects, working on the deployment tools for fake news detection in the TRESCA project, and he is in charge of the deployment of privacy and enhancing technologies in the Spears project. Today, in his keynote, he will discuss with us about trust and addressing the main challenges associated to privacy protection and security management. So, David, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Nicola, and thank you very much let me introduce the main goals of our research and the core of our work in the H2020 projects, Spears and Tresca. As Nicola has underlined, I'm from the Spanish National Research Council, specifically from the Institute of Physical Technologies and Information Theory. And I'm going to address here the more relevant aspect of our work in collaboration with other thematic areas. What I'm going to try to highlight is that in this very moment it's very difficult to tackle more of the most challenging aspect of the configuration of the cyber space without the proper collaboration between people from the technological areas, but also from social sciences and all these areas related to the human being, let's say. And I'm gonna try to summarize the most relevant aspect of our research in my group. First, I'm gonna discuss a very short introduction about the main purpose of our research and the specific context where we work, and some aspects related to the application in the specific arena of cybersecurity, the main challenges there in cybersecurity, and some conclusions, and maybe some words about the needs we have right now in the configuration of our working team in the context of the Spirit project. And this talk is mainly concerned about the so-called digital era. If we are more specific about that, we should talk about the data era. We have right now a very complicated scenario where data and ICT technologies, information and communication technologies, are more important today, and they are so important that in the different stages from the data gathering to aggregation of this data, storage, analyze, archive, and sharing, we have plenty of different design decisions that can somehow determine the way of if they are interacting in the different scenarios related to our daily activities. We have to be very careful about that. We have to be very careful about the different assumptions we are conducting and performing when we are designing systems in all the different stages I have highlighted here, because all these decisions have a very high impact in the conclusion we achieve across our different operational scenarios. And this is very important because we organize our life around all the different results from this data life cycle, from the configuration of the different technologies around the data life cycle. If we don't organize our work in a proper way to be sure that ICT are properly implemented, we can have problems. For example, we can have problems when we try to get a plane. Maybe we are not able to get into the plane because the system is not working, because we have a denial of service or some kind of attack. So we have to be very aware about this kind of dependency. When we are talking about trust, this trust, this is something we have to take into account, that in many occasions, this trust is a way of be dependent respect to a third party, and this dependency can be very critical in many occasions. And for example, also we can have a problem when we try to reach our own information if we have not protected our system in a proper way against ransomware attacks, and then in this scenario we don't have access to data. So data availability is not guaranteed, and this is a very big problem in the very context we are living right now. And also we can have very very critical problem related to our own health. We don't protect biodevices in a proper way. For example, analyzing all different attacks that can be performing using or getting use of site channel information, then we can have a very critical problem that can conduct to a health problem. So this is even more critical. It's not just that we cannot use our data. It means this kind of problem that we can have a problem related to life continuity. Let's say. So we should take care of ICT in a proper and convenient way. And to do so, we should try to answer some different questions. For example, we should try to define who can access information. This is something that is the one of the cores in the information security. What can the people, the person that can access the information, what can she do with the information? How long should she have access to information? And how can she access information? And finally, something that is really, really important in this very in the current scenario is when a source of information can be considered as trusted. This is something that is very difficult and is a main challenge right now. It is not only necessary to control access to information and to control information. Information, the different types of accessing and modifying information. We need also to have some kind of means to ponder the credibility of the different sources of information. Traditionally, we have tackled this kind of question by means of three main properties: confidentiality, integrity, and availability. We can protect confidentiality, guaranteeing that only the people with enough rights can access information. We can perform integrity controls in order to be sure that information had not been modified in an inappropriate way. And finally, we need different resources as backups or different types of redundancy in order to guarantee data availability, resources availability, assets availability. From a very classical point of view, one of the main means in order to guarantee this property has been cryptography. For sure, we need plenty of more resources, but one of the very basic means is cryptography. And we can leverage some symmetric or secret key cryptography. And also we can combine this with asymmetric or public key cryptography in order to protect the previous properties. In the case of secret key, we have two users with our sharing a secret key session, and they can construct a confidential channel. The key problem here is how to share the secret key. In order to solve this problem, we have asymmetric cryptography where and user have a pair of a keys, the private key, which is the red key here in possession of Bob, and a public key, which is the green key, and anybody in possession of the green key, as Alice, can send information to Bob, just encrypting the information with the green key, and finally Bob can decrypt the information just using the private key. That's a way to get a proper mean in order to share a symmetric key and to construct a confidential channel. If the source of the information, in this case Alice, has a pair of keys, the private key, the red one, and the green key, as the public key, then she can encrypt information with her private key, and the receiver can verify that indeed Alice is the one that has created the red message, because the only person that is in possession of the related key to a known public key is Alice. So this is a way to have an attribution procedure that is very useful, with a lot of restriction for sure in this very context, but it's a way to perform attribution by means of cryptographic procedures. The only problem here is that we cannot be sure that Alice is indeed a proper person behind a proper private key. So we need a third party, which is going to be the one that is going to show the people that indeed Alice is the person that is in possession of a specific public key. This is the certification authority who is going to sign a public key using a digital certificate according to the X509 standard, and this is the classical procedure in order to have a centralized way of trust management. This is the main scenario we are dealing in this very context, with all the different confidential and authenticated channels, and with all the complexity associated to this kind of ecosystem. But indeed, we have a procedure to conduct trust centralization. In some different scenario, we have a dependency related to a third party that is centralized. And in this very moment, there is a very important effort in order to decentralize this kind of way of fostering trust from a technological point of view. A technological meaning of trust. Later, I will talk about different ways of considering which is trust. This trust and centralization basically is going to be conducted in the concrete case of digital identity as a way to project a physical identity into the cyberspace. We can associate different digital identities with all the different consideration about the meaning of digital identity and all these kind of things, but we can have a physical identity and a set of digital identities that are associated to this physical identity, and we can conduct this kind of association using, for example, something the people know, which is a password, something the people have, any kind of authentication token, or something that the people are, biometrics. In the case of biometrics, we have witnessed along these last years a lot of different problems, because in some many scenarios there is a very dangerous confusion between identification and authentication procedures, and this kind of confusion have a very critical implication from the point of view of system security. This is something that have conducted to plenty of problems. And also we have the problem related of the dependency with respect to a third party, the one that is controlling, managing all the different authentication and verification procedures. We have the problem of the insider threats. Always we have the problem of the insider threats where we are depending somehow on a third party. Here we have a summary of different data breaches that can be analyzed using different sources. For example, we can consider the Troy Hans project have been bombed in order to be sure that any specific platform has not been victim of an attack, and in order to validate that indeed our credentials are not compromised. But in plenty of many occasions, we have to conclude that maybe the best option is to change our credentials because we have been involved in a data breach. And also we have plenty of problems related to the implementation of a specific solution for protecting information. For example, the crack problem, which affected a lot of different implementation, which was a very critical problem. Also, we have problem, as I have highlighted before, because of the confusion between the authentication and identification. Here we have an example where authentication is conducted by face recognition. We are able to devise using, for example, a 3D printer, a system to copy by means of the 3D printer I have underlined the face of somebody. Maybe we can evade the authentication control of the device, in this case an iPhone X, and we can get into the system. This is a very easy and very simple example, but this is a practical example. Another example regarding the confusion between identification and authentication, we have a lot of different examples. I have provided here two examples. One about by Japanese researchers, which uses high definition images with fingerprints in order to devise a way to overcome fingerprinting control in authentication procedure. So it's a very important and critical problem. Another problem is associated to the system of side channels attacks. This is something that is very, very complicated to be solved. This is something we have to analyze in a very exhaustive way. Otherwise, we can have a side problem that can conduct to the extraction of secret parameters of our system. This is something we have to be very, very, very careful. In the end, we need to devise, we need to think about a way, an integral way to align business goals. What I mean with business goal is the goals we are trying to achieve by means of the different implementation in the different application context. We have to align these goals with the legal and normative requirements and also with the technological possibilities. Without technology, we cannot implement the proper way of protecting our information systems. But we also need a culture about the proper use of technology in coherence with the restrictions that are related to our social system. So we need to combine in a proper way these three different things. That's the reason why I was talking in the very beginning of the talk about the need of conducting interdisciplinary work in this very current scenario of cybersecurity. We cannot achieve cybersecurity goals without combining these three dimensions of our social reality, and this is part of our effort in the Spears project, the secure platform for ICT system rooted at the silicon manufacturing process, which is the name of our current H2020 project, where we are performing the implementation of the so-called root of trust at the silicon level And then we are providing security at this, from the silicon level to an open hardware architecture based in RISC-V approach. Upon this RISC-V approach solution, we are implementing a trusted execution environment. And upon that, we are conducting the design and implementation of privacy respectful protocols and remote attestation procedures. Upon that, we are going to conduct different communication and security protocols in order to assess that indeed the communication in the different application context. In specific, we are considering two use cases, one in Industry 4.0 and another one in 5G communication. They are leveraging the root of trust through RISC-V architecture, and by means of a trusted execution environment, we are going to conduct the implementation of different communication protocols with the requirements imposed by the criteria of security by default and by design. This is something we are going to be working. These are the people's involved in this kind of such a big effort. We will manage along this coming 3 years in order to contribute to the technological independence in the European scenario, according to the spirit, for example, of the European Processor Initiative, and in the same vein as has been highlighting in the so-called Industrial Alliance for Processors and Semiconductor Technologies. As I have pinpointed, we are conducting this design from the hardware level through the software level and the application and network layers. And this is gonna be as I have mentioned, the roadmap of our work in this Spears project. This is a very challenging goal, but this is the spirit of the project. And the main results are gonna be applied for sure in the cybersecurity scenario in order to foster a specific way of tackling the domain related to the cybersecurity science with proper methodologies, leveraging the different stages and procedures for confidentiality, integrity, availability, and enhancing not only confidentiality, integrity, and availability. We are also working for sure, as it should be, auditability procedures, authorization mechanism, authentication solutions, in order to have an integral solution that can be considered secure and safe, according to the specific requirements in concrete and defined application context. This is gonna be part of our work in order to enhance the original confidentiality, integrity, and availability scenario by means of the three golden rules: authentication, auditability, and the authorization, and also providing accountability solution. This is something we will provide by means of decentralization procedures. This is something that's gonna be conducted through the different levels involved in the construction of the so-called perimetral security, but taking into account that that perimetral security upon the three golden goals, plus confidentiality, integrity, and availability, are not enough in order to properly protect the scenario, the technological scenario where we are working now. Right now, it's very difficult to talk about physical boundary. We don't have the possibility of defining in a proper way a physical perimeter. So we have to manage this. This is something we know from a long time. It's not something that has emerged right now. It's a very long problem, let's say. And a way of addressing this kind of problem can be by considering main challenges in this very scenario. Challenges that are related to outsourcing means, related to data and computing, problems related to privacy, problems related to distributed trust management, and finally, how recent technologies can contribute to tackle this kind of challenge. For example, using a blockchain solution. This could be a way of addressing this, or maybe it's a way of increasing the problems in this very scenario, because maybe it's not part of the solution, but part of the problem. But this is something we are considering in order to protect the cloud, something we are using without something that we are using as part of our normal activity, because we can manage a very complex system with a very agile and easy to use solution. For sure, we are somehow promoting different types of dependency, but this is something we have to take into account in order to balance the benefits from using an external resource through data and computing outsourcing and the security we are achieving. This is something we have to balance. We have to achieve a trade-off between the capability of controlling by our own resources and how we can manage very complex scenarios. So this is something we have to combine in a proper way. This is a trade-off we have to achieve. This is something we have to take into account. This is just to recall that indeed, when we are using this kind of resources, the cloud, in the end, we are just using the computer of some guy. This is not something that is arising as magic, but we are somehow accepting we have a dependency through by means of a third party. This is something we have to take into account in order to analyze the security risk and the privacy risk. Identity can be in this very scenario modulated in order to enhance the perimeter in order to solve a classical problem at isolation and to be more agile, let's say, and to configure different types of a perimeter, not as the classical physical perimeter, something more flexible, let's say. Spears is going to contribute to this kind of approach in the very concrete scenario of public cloud storage services. We, along these last years, we have been working in developing at least easy methodologies in order to be sure that we are controlling this kind of dependency with respect to a third party in a proper way. And for such a goal, we have designed a very basic methodology based in 10 different recommendations, just to be sure that we are able to use cryptographic tools in order to foster zero trust schemes. We can have zero trust schemes even if we are adopting public clouds. This is something we can leverage and we can think about it. And in this work I have underlined, as a matter of fact, we are providing a simple solution in order to achieve this zero trust scheme even in the case of adopting and using public clouds. And what I am doing here is very simple. We are performing client side encryption, and we are leveraging different cloud providers in order to avoid the dependency with respect to only one service provider. This is something we can use because we have plenty of free services. It's free, but we have a dependency there, so it finally is not so free, but at least we can use it as a storage medium without low cost, and we can leverage plenty of these cloud services and performing client-side encryption and integrity verification by means of digital signatures in order to build up this zero trust model I was highlighting. other solutions we can are based on the use of some specific implementation, for example, as Mega or using Proton Mail, where we have client-side encryption, but we can conduct client-side encryption in a very easy way using using a public implementation, for example, as PGP or other cryptographic suites. Mm? This is something that is possible if we manage to do so. Mm? Now, this is just underlying the points I have been highlighting before, and this is something that I have highlighted also, that we should try to be not dependent only in one service provider. We have plenty of service providers that are free, at least as a first approximation, are free. We can use Google Cloud for free. We can use a lot of Dropbox. We can use Amazon. So we can combine all of them in a way similar, for example, to a RAID system with different redundancies in order to implement a backup system with client-side encryption. This is something that we can conduct. This is the core of the work. I have pinpointed in the previous slides, and as a matter of fact, it's part of this work I'm highlighting now, the encrypted cloud, which is a solution to performing client side encryption and to foster cloud redundancy in order to use in a secure way public cloud services. This is something that very easy to implement. If we foster a good culture of leveraging public and open source code and open source project, for encrypting of our information. This is something that we should and can promote. In this vein, what we are doing somehow is to go from a classical cloud stack to a cloud stack where we are implementing an additional layer that is going to provide a security service. So we can say that somehow we are promoting security as a service. This is something we can promote by means of the implementation of a specific technology, but also by means of fostering the adoption by the end users of a solution that should be designed and implemented with a human-centered approach. This is something very important. Technology is not useful if it is not used by end users. And this is something that we people from security, we forget about it in too many occasions we forget that technology has to be used by end users. And what I mean by end users, end users are not only developers, and users are citizens, and this is something that is more and more important right now. We cannot promote technological trust if we don't include the end users in the whole life cycle of the development of the software and hardware for security, for cybersecurity. Another problem in this various scenario is how we use automatic procedures in order to foster decision making. We have different approach. One where we think that by means of automatic procedures we can solve everything, and complex problems are only solved by technology in a very approximate way. We need very complicated solution where we are able to integrate again business goals, legal requirements, and technological concerns. If we are not able to integrate all of these different dimensions, we are not achieving the solution of these complex problems. This is something very, very important. That's the reason why I'm showing here the different approach by Wittgenstein against the approach by Turing. It's a very simple approach, but it's a way to confront him. Just a technological solution and a solution that is integrating different aspects of what is a social system. Because for sure, we have the problem that in many occasions we think that it's very easy to describe the facts that are determining the way the system are evolving, but in plenty many of occasions, it's not difficult, it's not easy to identify these facts. As a matter of fact, it's not easy to identify the proper data in order to characterize these so-called facts, because this kind of thing that we are working with raw data is something that is not properly accurate. The concept of data is a very complex concept. As a matter of fact, in plenty of many occasions, raw data is an expression of a clear oxymoron, a contradiction between what we mean by raw data and finally the data we are managing, the data we are working with. This is something we have to take into account. Otherwise, we are going to have systems that are somehow biased in a critical way. And we can for sure promote the proper implementation of accurate automatic decision making and decision taking. But right now, one of the more adopted solution is to put again the human in the loop related to decision configuration, decision making, and decision taking, and this is a very important approach in the whole technological scenario. But for sure, in the thing related to data curation, because this is something very important. What we mean by trust in the technological setup is very different from what we mean by trust in a social system. In social system, by trust we mean actors that have a behavior that is benevolent, that has integrity. And that has competence. Competence, integrity, and benevolence are the three dimensions of trust in the system in social system. And technological trust is constructed in a different way. This is something we analyze in this work, which is a collaboration between people from social science and people from cybersecurity. Sure, we are only two people, but we are representing these two knowledge areas, and we have extended that in the very context of disinformation characterization and debunking. This is something we have conducted using different criteria in the very context of the Tresca project, the project I underlined at the very beginning of the presentation. Here, what we have conducted is a way of integrating different sources to ponder news credibility. We have implemented different automatic ways of, for example, verifying headlines, performing different kinds of cyber attribution, and we have combined this with different solutions in order to evaluate the level of credibility of pieces of information. This is something very complex and cannot be addressed without a proper integration of, for example, we have addressed this in the very context of science communication. So we have conducted all this work, all this effort in collaboration with people from social science, from journalism, and from science communication in general. So this is a part of the of this project. We have implemented a specific widget, which is a set of tools and also a methodology. We are now trying to make it public and to offer this service to the community. This is something that we have achieved, and we want to extend it that in order to tackle the so-called hybrid threats, because this kind of use of information is very important for sure in the civil a scenario, but also has a very important dimension related to the cyber warfare dimension. And as a matter of fact, the use of even scientific news can be part of the so-called information operations in order to attack other country or in order to attack other institutions. So this is something that is very important right now, and that is part of the roadmap we are conducting in the context of Tresca, but also in other projects we are working now in our group, in order to tackle not only problems related to the curation of information in science communication, but also in the broad scope of information operations and hybrid threats. And to conclude, I'm going to talk about some works we are conducting in the very context of privacy. In this context of privacy, we have also a problem related to the conceptualization of the problem. We have different approaches to the concept of privacy. For example, the people working on law, they have a proper definition for privacy that is not exactly the same definition that we have in information privacy, and which is also not the same definition with what we have when we are dealing with identity privacy and anonymity. We have different dimensions of privacy. Privacy is a very complex problem. So when we are underlying that we are protecting privacy, we have to be very careful because we have to define specifically what we mean by privacy and how we are protecting privacy. It's a very complex, a very elusive problem, a very elusive concept. Taking into account how information is constructed, we have to consider that privacy can be eroded if we are monitoring in a direct way in a specific set of people. If we manage to get in an indirect way information from these people, if we are able to get information by, for example, by buying information from a specific platform where personal information is stored. These three different levels of getting personal information should be considered in order to conduct privacy impact analysis, for example, in the vein of what is imposed by the General Data Protection Regulation in Europe, the GDPR. If we manage this from the point of view of identity, we can conduct advanced identity management procedures by distinguishing identification from linkability and from traceability. We can provide these three different properties in a different way, not as a whole, but as specific processes. This is something very important if we want to protect privacy by means of identity protection. Linkability means that if we have two different operations, we can infer that two specific operations are related. This means that we are able to link operations. Traceability means that if we have a set of operations, we are able to know that all the operations are related to this a specific entity. So we have different procedures for linkability and different procedures for traceability. And in conventional digital signatures, we are not able to separate these procedures, but we need to separate these procedures, for example, if we want to implement vulnerability in the context of e-voting and e-coin, if we want to provide linkability in order to achieve fairness in anonymous communication, and in order to provide traceability, for example, if we want to have privacy respect for e-commerce with promotions and fraud detection. We need to have different ways of providing these different tools. This is something we have addressed, for example, by extending the X509 protocol by providing fair anonymity. This is something we have also conducted in the very context of e-shopping by implementing different trade-offs in order to balance privacy and utility in e-commerce, using advanced group signature schemes and distinguishing the different entities we have in our platform, in a proper way. This is something we can conduct, and that is this is something very useful in the very context of e-voting, for example, where we also need to distinguish different procedures that should be usable. If they are not easy to use, we are going to have a problem. But we can combine different procedures in order to distinguish which is authentication for the voting procedure and the distribution and the counting of the votes. So we can split the different trust domain here using specific cryptographic tools in order to implement e-voting scheme. We have different words about that. In the context of anonymous communications, we can use classical systems, and we can combine, for example, Tor system in order to have a privacy protection system. The problem is that in many occasions, Tor is related to illegal activities, and in many occasions, service providers are blocking Tor because they assume that anybody using Tor is going to conduct illegal actions. So, since technology is not defined by the way, but it's not defined by the way it's used, bad technologies emerge because it's used in a bad way. We have to distinguish which is a cause from a correlation. Let's say a cause is how technology is implementing, and the correlation is how the technology is used. If we are able to distinguish these two things, we can provide, for example, system in order to conduct fair anonymous communication by providing fair anonymity, for example, in Tor. This is something we kept conducting in this work, and what we have implementing is somehow something that can be going as a fairness as a service in order to balance anonymity, utility, and control. So this is something we can conduct and we can use in a proper way.
David, you have 5 minutes left.
Okay. So I'm finishing. Finally, part of our work in the projects we are involved in are gonna be very related to the proper deployment and use of a blockchain, taking into account the main technologies using blockchain, blockchain is conducted by interleaving in a proper way the communication P2P communication protocols with the cryptographic layers, and finally a social system configured by people that want to use this technology in a proper way. This is something very important. We have three different layers, and if we don't have security in these different layers, in these three layers, we are not gonna have a secure blockchain implementation, blockchain or distributed ledger technology, if we are more accurate. Blockchain is just a type of this distributed ledger technology. For example, we have to take into account that in many occasions we are assuming some properties as immutability. We are assuming that for sure, but immutability is something that is achieving by means of the cryptographic procedures, because the people involved in the governance of the scheme want to assure that this property is guaranteed. If these people that is involved in the governance of blockchain achieve an agreement in order to modify the immutability property, they are gonna do that. This is the case, for example, of the hard forks in plenty of public blockchains. So immutability is a property that is finally achieved by means of cryptographic solution if governance is coherent with this property. Otherwise, immutability can be revoked. This is something that we should take into account. So in a specific case of application, this assumption about immutability is of high interest, for example, for auditing and forensics. It's very important and very, very relevant in there. For sure, we have to be very careful about the way we are recording information in order to be compliant with the GDPR and a lot of the restrictions, but we can manage this in a proper way. This is not a big deal. In order to do so, we have to take into account that in the EVM blockchain is a very old technology because it's very based on very old technologies that have been integrated in a very interesting way, but we have a long tradition in order to foster and implement distributed ledger technologies, and there is plenty of work in order to improve this because we have a lot of contribution from a long time about that, and we have to define the different ways of conducting authentication and authorization in this very context. If we manage so, and if we finally conclude that the blockchain is a solution for us, we can conduct, for example, the proper management of a very complex scenario as it is, for example, the management system of commercial aircraft leasing. We have plenty of example of this vein. We can conduct a very rigorous way of tracing law requirements into properties of the blockchain. This is something we have doing this work, but we can extend it to another scenarios, but take into account that in many occasions, in the end, what we are using is something more similar to a database than a blockchain. That's the reason why I have used this image, because in plenty of occasions, in the end, we are not using a distributed ledger technology, but something that is too centralized. So this is something very important. So if we want to perform the transition from the centralization schemes to decentralized trust, we have to manage to use the proper application of decentralization technologies, which is not easy, and which requires a very advanced skills in the protocols communication and cryptographic tools. In the very concrete scenario of investment crowdfunding, decentralized finance, we have to be very careful because there are some bad consequences of the use of unregulated scenarios. This is something we have analyzed in this work, and we have underlined that in many occasions we are assuming trust without a proper verification. This is something very important. We have to be very careful in order to properly assess that the technology is indeed incoherent with the legal requirements and the business goals, according also to the technological possibilities. This is something very important. To conclude, what we need to define in a proper way is what we mean by trust, which is not easy, and how we can build a network of trust. And in this very current scenario, this is only possible if we are able to foster a proper coordination between the industry and the academy. As a matter of fact, as we know, plenty of people from the academy, because of a very set of different things, they have decided to leave the academy in order to work in the industry. This is very relevant right now, because it's something that we should take into account from the academy. Something is not working properly, I think. And in order to foster this proper combination, we have to manage the proper integration of the different knowledge areas that are involved in cybersecurity. We have plenty of different scenarios there. And this is something we have been working in the project that I have underlined. And something that we are going to conduct it in the context of peers, where, as a matter of fact, we are looking for people interested in collaborating with us. So with this, I'm going to conclude. Just to let you know that we are right now hiring people in order to implement the different working packages in Spurs. Specifically, we are trying to get people involved in the project as part of the Spurs team in Madrid. So if you want to work with us in a very beautiful city as in Madrid, you are more than welcome. This is all. Thanks for the attention. And if you have any kind of question, here I am to try to answer you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. So I'll try to squeeze at least one question. So if you have any question, please use the raise hand button in Zoom, or just write your question in the chat. Don't be shy. Okay, it seems No one is raising their hand, so I will try to give you one question. So you touched up about it's not enough to we can't solve this problem only with standards, laws, and technology improvements, right? So you mentioned this. So one thing that I was asking myself was, what can we as security researchers and practitioners do to promote a societal change about this? Because like right now, for example, if we think about the education about these matters, I believe that the average person gets to deal with these matters when they are doing training in their jobs, right? Mm-hmm. It's nothing we discuss in schools. And so I'm wondering, what is your take on what can we do about it? How can we affect society so that these matters are addressed in a systematic way?
It's a very complex problem indeed, because we as cryptographic engineers, let's say, we can implement tools that are easy to use and easy to develop. We can do so, but also we need the collaboration from the policymakers in order to foster indeed the use of the tools we are implementing. It's very funny, this kind of thing, for example, now related to the distributed ledger technology, because finally, in a very fast way, let's say, the people are very concerned about the use of functional cryptography, let's say. But functional cryptography, group signatures, resignatures, zero knowledge, which is now a very used term, a lot of people have been working on that for a very long time. But right now, they have considered that this is a very interesting technology. This is something that we can contribute in order to foster the adoption by the industry by implementing easy to use tools. That is something very, very important. But related to the way that finally the end user are going to adopt the tools, we should try to be involved in a specific initiative related to, I don't know, citizen science, citizen events. We can contribute to science communication, but the thing is that we don't have enough time. So that's the reason why we need the collaboration of policymakers, and we need the contribution of the politicians. We cannot do that without our own effort. That's something very difficult to combat. But at least we can press and we can underline that it's not possible to have a secure ecosystem without the inclusion of the human being in the loop. It's not possible. So this is something that is very compelling, but we have to manage in order to achieve our goals to get involved the end users. I don't know if I guess I am not, I have not answered the whole question because it's a very complicated question. For example, related to the design of cryptographic protocols, we have for sure all the people working on human-computer interaction in the security scenario, and we have all these efforts related to security ceremonies. That is something that at least is considering the human factor as part of the development. This is something that is not so common, and that this is something we used to forget. So at least we have tools, and at least we have new ways of addressing problems that previously has not been properly addressed.
Perfect, thank you very much.
Thank you, bye.